chapter 1, beginning at verse 18. Matthew chapter 1, verse 18. Now the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise, when as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privately. But while he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife, for that which is conceived is of her, in her is of the Holy Ghost. And she shall bring forth a son. Thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Now all this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, Behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. Then Joseph, being raised from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord had bidden him, and took unto him his wife. And he knew her not till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and she called his name Jesus. Thank you. You may be seated. The last couple of weeks or so, maybe three, we've been singing Christmas carols and singing, you know, and as Jared played this morning in our choir, and then the congregational singing and Karen singing about Jesus, about Christmas. And what a wonderful time of year, isn't it? Although there are some sad times of the year. I was telling someone the other day, and may even said it here, I think last week or so, that the most time of suicides takes place around Christmas. So it's a terrible thing. And then here we have Christmas now with all the trouble there in Connecticut at the Sandy Hook School there. And as I was sharing with Karen, my nephew called the other day and he said, Tom, I want you to pray for us, pray for my family. He said that his wife's cousin was one of the children that was killed there. She was 6 years of age. And so a terrible thing for perhaps at Christmas. But you know what? We need to understand that no matter what takes place in this life, that without Christ, there can be no Christmas. Right. You look at that word Christmas, and I want to look at those last three letters in the word Christmas. M-A-S. Anybody know what that means? Can you tell somebody what it means? Huh? I couldn't find any word in a dictionary that meant anything. M-A-S?
It's Spanish.
We're in America. In Spanish, it means more. Thank you. There you go. I don't like going to stores. Oh, never mind. That's another message. But no, in our language, in American language, it means there's nothing that it could mean. You can add to it. You can put another S on there and you'll have mass, which you know, and all that. Then you can take the M away and have as. So we find that you can do things to it, but it means nothing. So without the first part of that, it means nothing. Christ, without being in Christmas, means nothing. Wow. I like that, though, more. I have to keep that in mind. I'll preach, too. Exactly. Thank you. But Christ, without Christ, there is no Christmas. And I thought that without Christ, certainly in Christmas, there could be no rest for the weary soul without Christ, could there? I realize that throughout Christmas there's a lot of hustle and bustle and all these things. You don't believe it? Go to Walmart. Go somewhere during Christmas season shopping and you'll see the hustle and the bustle. I still think they ought to put traffic lights in malls. In malls. So people will observe them. When somebody's coming, you've got to stop for that red light. But people run over you. But not only that, but there's no rest without Christ for that weary soul. And sometimes we look at that weary soul and say, how can we get rest for the troubled soul that we have? Well, without Christ there is none, because Jesus says in Matthew chapter 11 verse 28, he said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Come unto me, he says. He said, take my yoke upon me, on you, for I am meek and lowly, and you shall find rest for your soul. How can we rest without Christ? There can be none without Him. Jesus, what a lovely name. There is just something about that name that gives us rest for our troubled soul. My same nephew had called me from Cold Springs, Kentucky. I was here at church yesterday, and he called, and he said, "Are you at church today working?" I said, "Well, I'm down here." He said, I said, "Where are you?" He said, "I'm down at your church too." I said, "Where are you?" He said, "I'm outside." I said, "Well, open the front door and come on in." So he came in, and we got to talking about that, and tears got in his eyes, came in his eyes, because we're sharing about the little girl, their family who was killed there. And he made this statement: "I don't know what they're going to do without Jesus." I thought, I don't know what any of us can do without him, do you?
That's right.
There can be no rest for that weary soul without him. There can be no Christmas without him. You see, he says in Isaiah chapter 53 and verse 4, he says, "Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted." He said, he's saying there that he carries our sorrows. He carries them. A load gets heavy sometimes if you're bearing it along, doesn't it? It gets very heavy. I think that there can, you know, and as I get older, I see this, and I realize that sometimes when we're younger and it doesn't seem like there's a load too heavy for us. I think about some of these guys, you know, like Aaron and all these guys that's got, you know, the bulk up here. Now, I'm talking about muscle. How great it is for them to be able to lift things. And we can look back. Sometimes when we were younger, we were able to lift a lot of things. But as we get older, we find that things that we used to lift, that we need help carrying. But aren't you glad today that Jesus said, "I will carry your sorrows"? Sometimes our sorrows get so heavy, we try to bear them alone. But you've got to realize, you can't handle them alone. You can't do it by yourself. Oh, it's great. Our families can help. Our friends can help when they pray for us and just put their arms around us. Again, my nephew said, "I don't know what to say to them." I said, "You don't have to say anything. What you need to try to do is just wrap your arms around them and let them know that you care." Jesus carries our sorrows. Without him, the load would be too heavy. Without Christ, there's no Christmas. There's no meaning there. Without Christ, there is no living water for the thirsty soul. Remember in John chapter 4, we find where Jesus was there at the well with the Samaritan woman. And he began to ask her something to drink and all these things. And she said, "Well, you know," he said, "if you'd ask me, I'd give you something." She said, "Sir, you don't even have anything to get the water out of." "Well, the water out of the well with." Jesus said to her, he said, "The water that you're drinking of today out of that well will cause you to thirst again." He said, "But the water I can give you is water that will cause you to never have to thirst again." Because you see, Jesus is the living water, isn't he? He is the living water. I think that he tells us in Isaiah chapter 12, he said that living water, which is Jesus Christ, contains joy. Contains joy. Wow. And without Christ and Christmas, there could be no joy. We sing this song, "Joy to the World, the Lord has come." Without Christ, there could be no joy. In Christmas, there could be no joy in our lives. I'm glad, as I said time and time again, that our joy does not depend on the outward things, aren't you? Because if it depended on outward things, we'd never be joyous. But it depends on what we have within us, and that's Jesus Christ. So without Christ, there'd be no living water for that thirsty soul. Matthew chapter 5 says, "Blessed are they who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled." Talking to a man last night who just got back from Bolivia on a mission trip. He was gone about 22 days. And he said, "Tom," he said, "it was an experience." He said, "I went over there," he said, "to drill wells by hand." He said, "to drill them by hand." And he said, "It's amazing, they don't have water." He said, "But we drill those wells." I think he said they finally, in those 22 days, drilled about 6 wells. He said it was quite an experience to know that when you're going down in that sand, he says, not like us. He said, when you start to drill in one here, you're going to hit limestone. And it's